information, if you have this information, your penetration testing can also be improvised to that factor. Then you know, oh, this information is being discovered, this is a huge vulnerability. Right? So this can help you to improvise your risk-based penetration testing. Next, severity levels are based on technical parameters. As I said, SQL injection, maybe you will rate high, maybe you will rate low. Process scripting, you will rate high. But look at the application. Whether the application is a test bed or a real application or something which will not stop the business altogether. Okay? Then risk levels in reports are assigned post factor. Means, as I said earlier, that you find SA and SA and you log in to database. So you said vulnerability is hacked, but then it goes to the actual administrator, you will say, oh, this was a test machine. So your finding goes through. However, in this case, test cases additionally built on the risk scenarios. That in risk-based penetration testing, you are aware that this is a test machine. Okay, now what will you build scenarios? Say, for example, someone compromises the test machine. But this test machine is a part of the user's network. So, someone hacking into the system can further go ahead and compromise the other systems on the network and show that. That see, from this machine I was able to hack into the other machine, or at least I was able to do a code scan, or at least I was able to find a vulnerability which is not patched. So then it creates an impact to the system administrator that this machine I have not patched because of which other machines might get hacked. Right? Then, audience for the reporting is usually the IT and the security teams in traditional penetration testing. You know that for example, if there is a firewall administrator or web administrator, okay, he only knows the appliance or the application. So generally the audience is that. However, in risk-based penetration testing, audience is also includes the business process owners. As I said earlier, again the same example, that it's not a test machine. Who can tell that it's a test machine? Only the business process owner can tell that it's a test machine. Right? So these are few of the things what the differentiation is. A lot of things might not be clear. Let's look at one or two case studies. Okay? Now, this is a case study. This is basically a penetration testing we did some 3-4 months back. Okay? So, it is a corporate banking platform. So, as you know, it is a bank for which we are doing. Okay? They allow three logins. First is the maker who enters the transaction into the system. So, there is someone who initiates the transaction. Right? Then there is a verifier who can check the transaction data, that is whether he has filled up the form correctly, whether his account really has that much money, whether he has the limit, whether he can bypass that limitation, or what is the upper limit. Generally, he cannot do above 10,000, so it has to be done by someone else. All these things a verifier will verify. And finally, there will be an authorizer who will say, okay, done. Whatever has been there, I am ready to pass this transaction. So each screen in the web application is different. That is, if suppose the maker logs it, he will see some set of buttons which a maker and authorizer will not have. Okay. Similarly, when a verifier logs it, he might not see some buttons which are there for the maker and the authorizer. And finally, same for the authorizer, that he will not be able to see something which is there for the maker and the verifier. Is the idea clear that what that web application is about? Any doubts? Right. So then, security is implemented. Now, when we actually did the whole enumeration, the whole testing and all, we found out that security is implemented by restricting access to URLs that allow certain transactions. Means what? That I'll tell you later, which actually will see this. And parameters that trigger certain transactions. Means what? This whole concept was based on the fact that the parameters which are coming from the end user, okay, are something which is more than enough to tell them that, okay, this is the only genuine. Means what? The very fact that, like, I will take another example. Suppose you are doing a code scan. A lot of people do code scans, right? So, one of the first code scan was TCP full connect scan, which is based on three-way handshake. Okay, you send a send, you get a send hack, then you send an add, and then you send a reset. So that's a full TCP connect scan. Fail or a reset, because you want to just terminate that, so you are not interested in sending the data. Okay? Now, then people thought that, okay, when I send a SID, I get a SID. Is it not more than enough for me to tell that the port is open? Right? So this way, same thing was applied here, right? The very fact that this parameter is coming from this end user is saying that he is a verifier. very, so there are certain parameters for a verifier, certain parameters for only exclusive for authorizer, exclusively for the maker. So if at all the request is coming, having this parameter is more than enough for them to say that okay, this is a verifier, but this is a wrong concept. Right? There has to be multiple things that needs to be checked before the parameter could be actually executed. Whether really the verifier sent that parameter or not, it's basically. So the case study, what it says, and basically the RA case study, that is understanding the business process. So we, when this project was given to us, we went on site. We were basically at telecom. So we, in the telecommunication, we first understood what this application is doing. So then we got to know that there is something called as maker, verifier and authorizer. Then we understood what the business case is. That what if the, say for example, these are some of the test cases. Then can a maker do something what a verifier does? Okay, if suppose the maker is able to crack his shell of verification making and he is now jumping to the verification zone. Okay, can he do that first of all? Then the same thing, okay, can verifier do something what an authorizer can do? Okay, now the verifier is breaking out of the shell and he is trying to become as an authorizer. And so on and so forth. That is, what is a client admin can do, what a web administrator can do. What if a person who can initiate the transaction, he is only verified and he is only authorized? So what are we looking at? We are looking at frauds, fraud actors. Okay, anyone can come make a transaction, himself only verify, himself only authorize and pass it across. So there will be no, what are we trying to address here is segregation of duties. Right? When you segregate duties, you achieve security. But in this case, you are doing the reverse way, so you are not achieving security. So you are trying to bypass it. Okay? So during the pen testing, we discovered something like this, that is the bank, okay, had an URL something called as bankpay.app/authorized-payment-action.action is available. This URL is only available to the authorizer. So when you log in as authorizer and you want to authorize a transaction, this URL needs to come across. So this is clear. Then, but what if the maker puts this in the browser? So what we did is that we copied the URL. Okay, logged in, clear cache, again logged in as a verifier. Okay, and again pasted that this URL as a verifier. Okay, and we tried to initiate and we tried to authorize the transaction. However, we were not succeeded. We didn't succeed. Why? Because when we use something called a local proxy, any local proxy, you know, Paros, Bobsu, Grappies, Fiddler, removed the URL and pasted this authorizer's URL. We tried to verify one transaction, authorize one transaction, but we failed. Why we failed? Because there was something which was blocking us. So we tried to find out, tried to further investigate why. So we used a local proxy. We found out there is a backend parameter which is giving us filter is equal to block. Then, so then we thought, okay, now there is a value called as, there is a parameter called as filter, and it is value having a as block. So now what is this parameter when an actual authorizer does? So again we logged in again as an authorizer and we saw and we tracked that URL and we saw that actually it was going filter is equal to submit to pay. So again we copied the URL, copied the parameter, we logged out and we logged in again as a verifier. Again we shooted this URL as a verifier and tried to authorize a transaction, which is not allowed for a verifier, right? And we changed this, again we tracked the parameter and changed the parameter from block for the parameter value filter as block to submit to pay and the transaction went in. Right? So we were able to in this way move further ahead of the, so we were able to break that shell of that verifier to authorize a transaction, which is not ideally allowed as a consequence. Okay? So understanding the business is very important. Now we wouldn't have come to know that these things are there for it. And if you look from a traditional perspective, what the max that the contestant might have done? He might have tried as coach or coach is equal to 1 or 1 or 1 or select and thread and thread version or something like that. He might have tried to put something, some malicious code or bad characters into that thing. But he wouldn't have thought of the fact that the business is working in this logic. And when you log in as verifier, these are the parameters going, which if I copy paste as a maker, will allow me to verify some transaction.
But
even
if I have a meter, but this is again part of authorization.
Right, again part of authorization. But what are we trying to address here is that we are trying to address the fact that if what if the verifier breaks out of a shell of being not just verifier, it's trying to authorize a transaction as a verifier. Is this clear that this concept is clear how we are trying to do? Okay. So who are so understanding the business includes some of the parameters. Okay, something like who the key actors are, right? It's employees, departments, customers, partners, vendors, investors, brokers, or franchises, who are they? Okay? Everyone has their own limitations, right? A franchise is someone who is not part of the organization. So he might not want something which an employee can do. Right? So the risk, if a franchisee can do the same thing as an employee, then there could be a chances of huge problems, which we don't know. Then what applications do they use? Do they use the same application? Do they use the same module in the application? Or do they have different application? Or do they call one module which calls another module? All these things you should understand from the business perspective. Then, what data do they access through these applications? That is, are they actually running, touching the main database? Say for example, if it is bank, are they actually touching the main database of where the salary and the account information is stored? Or whether they are accessing, or do they have read-only permissions? All these things. Okay. What are the risks if the actors turns back? That is, as I said, if a verifier is trying to do something which only an authorizer can do. What possibilities exist if an attacker should decide to misuse the data building fraud scenarios? Means, now, as I said, that suppose a person is doing, is making the transaction, he is only verifying it and he is only authorizing it. Okay? What could be the impact? Okay? From pen testing, traditional pen testing perspective, you will never consider this. Right? But from business risk-based penetration testing, you will see there could be a fraud scenario if someone does something like this. Is the you are getting the idea of what we are talking about? Sure. What is going on, sir? Great. Regulated now. This was about one of the case studies. Now look at the PCI case. That is the regulatory compliance that drives. Okay, so for PCI cases is for credit cards, as everyone knows. So for all credit card processing merchants, PCI DSS is applicable. Okay. Then quarterly or semi-quarterly you have to do the audits. Focus on new application security. Requires high level of protection of credit card data. Now there are no fines for non-compliance, but breaches could put the breaches of security could put you out of the business. Please. Whenever credit card information will come, there is one vendor, or you can say one guy, or one broker, or one basically just like our Big Bazaar we have. If one shopping mall always comes into the picture.
TJ Maxx.
TJ Maxx. Okay, so TJ Maxx is a guy who is one of the biggest shopping chains in the US. Okay, so whenever credit card fraud comes into the picture, their name is always there. It's like an association, close bond association. So, credit card information, if it is lost, there is no penalty. Okay? However, if you look in HIPAA, which is for healthcare, they said breach could put you out of the practice and fines are for non-compliance are usually very high. Okay? So, you need to consider from the fact that okay, you are doing a pen testing for a medical application. So, what could be the impact on how much level of fine they might have to put if this vulnerability is being exploited? Right. So this might give more impact. You will be adding a value to your pen testing report. Tomorrow you'll say, this is just SQL injection, fine, high level vulnerability. But is there any business risk out of this? No. Like everyone in the security knows that you know what the definition of vulnerability is, what the definition of threat is. Okay. What is the vulnerability? What is the vulnerability?
It actually
exists. It
exists in the application vulnerability.
What is a vulnerability?
It actually can lead to attack or threat.
So, but what is vulnerability at base level?
A loophole?
A loophole or a weakness. Right? It's a weakness. Right? Either a weakness is there. And then what is a threat?
That
is something which can exploit that vulnerability to do something malicious. Right? But not all vulnerabilities are really having threats. Like, I mean, one other example. Suppose in your finding, you say that the door is open. Okay, the door is not locked. Okay, or there is no violated culture. Okay, you put this as a finding, give it a higher recommendation. But then the client might say, but what is the big deal if my door is not locked? So I said, no.